find out the specific heat of water according to kinetic theory of gas. Apply kinetic theory on water and find out the specific heat of water. We have found out specific heat for solids before the break. How many flexible bonds a water molecule has? Only two hydrogen bonds. Three hydrogen bonds. Oxygen also makes hydrogen bond with the other hydrogen. There are three flexible bonds. So how many degree of freedom? 6. Salt also 6, this is also 6. How many degree of freedom? How many vibration modes are there? 9 vibration modes are there. Hydrogen atom has 3 vibration modes, X, Y, Z. Okay, flexible. Whenever there is a flexible bond, listen, whenever there is a flexible bond, the vibration can happen along X, Y, Z. It is free to vibrate in any direction. Okay, so how many degrees of freedom? 18. No, hydrogen, water molecule doesn't move freely. Okay, it will not leave everything else and start moving independently. So translation as well as rotational, zero, close to zero. Only vibrational. Okay, because it is held by the hydrogen bonds from three sides. So total 18 degree of freedom, all of you understood? Now find out the specific heat, how much it is. Three vibration modes for each atom of H2O. Total 9 vibration modes. So degree of freedom 9 into 2, 18. So energy will be what? 18 into 1 by 2 kT, 9 kT. Now tell me, what is the specific heat? 9 R. So specific heat of water should be 9 R joule per mole per Kelvin. Okay, 9 R is how much? R is 8.3. This is how much? 74.89 joule per mole per kg. Now tell me, per mole per Kelvin. Now tell me, what is the specific heat? Convert this into joule per kg per Kelvin. Convert it. Convert it. One mole has 18 grams, right? This much joule per mole. So basically 74.89 divided by 18 joule per gram per Kelvin. Yes or no? This is how much? 4.15 around joule per gram per Kelvin. And what is the actual value? 4.18. Actual value is 4.18. So very close to the actual value. So kinetic theory goes beyond the gases only. So you can apply the kinetic theory on solids as well as on liquid, and you will get a very close value of whatever is. So it's a very strong theory, that is why we are learning it separately. Okay? per kg it will be this into 1000. Alright? Any doubt? Any doubt in entire flow? Nothing? Okay. So this is related to finding specific heat using the kinetic theory. Now can you tell me, I missed one small portion at the start. So can you find out the average velocity or root mean square velocity in terms of temperature? Try doing it. As a function of temperature, find out the average velocity that we have found out. How we find average velocity? We square it, take the average and then take the square root. So how much is that? The hint is kinetic energy was written in terms of that average velocity. Okay. See, kinetic energy half mu square for monatomic. This is equal to what? 3 by 2 kT. Right? This is what we have derived already. Now, this can be written as 3 by 2 k can be written as number of. It is r divided by Avogadro number. Right? This is equal to half m into u square. What is small m is what? Mass of single atom. That into Avogadro number is what? Molar mass. Right? So this Avogadro number, when it multiplies with small m, it becomes molar mass. Molar mass is generally written as capital M. So capital M u square is equal to 3 by 2 RT. So from here, the velocity can be written as root over 3 RT by the molar mass. Okay? Fine, so if you know the temperature and molecular or the atomic mass of the molecule, you will be able to find out its RMS velocity. Okay, this is referred as RMS velocity because it is square, mean and then root. Okay. As expected, velocity is inversely proportional to mass. Heavier the molecule, lesser will be its velocity. And also it is directly proportional to root over temperature. So with temperature, the velocity should increase. In fact, temperature is nothing but kinetic energy of molecule only. Okay? So this is with respect to the RMS velocity. This I think you might have learned in chemistry as well. There you have most probable speed and the mean speed as well. Okay, the last concept of the chapter, the last thing. Write down mean free path. You are asking as if you have never heard of it. You have done this and you have written a test, midterm test on it. You never heard of mean free path? No. Heard of it? No. You prepared for midterm? Left it. Write down mean free path. देखो भाई, write down mean free path. Mean free path is the average distance between the two collisions. Mean free path is the average distance between the two collisions. And why are we finding it? Because it is there in the syllabus. Other reason? If suppose collision happens, if suppose a molecule comes and collides with another molecule, then after collision its velocity, you can't predict. Right now you know it is going like this. After collision it can go anywhere. Fine? So if lot of collisions are happening or mean free path is less, mean free path less means without going little further ahead it collides, then the gas, rather than going in a straight line, streamline way, it diffuses because molecules will collide and spread across. Fine. So if you have to manage a very thin flow of a gas, then you need to choose a gas which has higher mean free path. Okay, all these things will be useful when you do engineering. You'll learn more about it, why it is so useful, but I'm just telling you the crux of everything. So that is why we are finding a mean free path. Alright, now suppose there is a atom which is going like this. Now if it doesn't collide, how will be its motion? Will go straight line. Reason? Newton told us. So because there is no external force, it will go in a straight line. Right? So between the collisions, the molecules will go in a straight line. Okay? Let's say that its diameter is given. Diameter is D. All of you draw this. So if collision doesn't happen, then we follow this path. And it is going to collide anything that comes inside this dotted path. Are you getting it? Okay. So it will not collide with this atom, but it will collide with that atom. And it will just touch this atom and it touch that atom. Fine. So basically, the center of the neighboring atoms should be inside this cylinder for this atom to collide. Getting it? So the radius of this cylinder will be diameter of the atom itself. So if you confine everything in a cylinder of radius which is equal to diameter of the atom, then anything inside this will collide with that. Okay, and this atom is coming from outside. It was outside the cylinder, now it is going in, and will collide anything that is coming inside the cylinder. Is this clear? Okay, so how many collisions will happen? Number of collisions will be as many molecules or atoms as there are in the cylinder, and this cylinder is imaginary. Okay, so if n is the number of atoms per unit volume, okay, and in delta t time, this distance will be how much? V into delta t. Okay, so how many number of molecules will be inside this cylinder? N into V delta, that's it. Into pi d square, na? Pi d, this is the volume. So that many atoms will be there inside the cylinder, and this many collisions will happen, isn't it? Any doubts? No doubts. So in delta t time, this much collisions are happening. So in 1 second, how many collisions will happen? This divided by delta t or not? Right? So please write down. In 1 second, you'll have n v into pi t square collisions. Okay, now tell me time between the two collisions. How much time it will take between the two collisions? D these are the number of collisions in 1 second. So how much will be the time between the two collisions? This is number of collision. Time between two collisions is what? 1 by this. Are you getting it? This much collision in 1 second. So 1 divided by this much will be the time between the two collisions. Suppose these are 5 collisions. 5 collisions in 1 second. So 1 collision in 1 by 5 seconds. So that's what I am telling you. Okay? So 1 divided by nv pi d square, this will be equal to 2. Time between two collisions. Average time between two collisions. Now tell me distance between the two collisions. Aris, this is time. Velocity is v. So velocity into time. This is velocity into time. Right? So, yes. So the mean free path should be equal to velocity into that. Right? Which will be 1 divided by n pi d square. D is the diameter of the molecule. Bigger the molecule, more will the collision, less will be the collision. More will the collision and mean free path will be lesser. It will travel less distance and collide. Getting it? Now tell me, we have made some stupid assumptions here. What are those? So whenever some stupid things are like, we have done it. So tell me what you guys have assumed. Tell me. All particles, all these atoms we are assuming to be stationary. Please write down stupid assumption 1. All particles or all the atoms are stationary but 1. What is the second stupid assumption? Center to hai nahi. It is imaginary center, I said. Okay, so same center ban gaya. So what is the other assumption? When the collision happens, if this moving atom collides, it doesn't change its path. It keeps on going in a straight line. Getting it? Understood? You understood? No. Kind of is not that. You are not paying enough attention. Okay? So, kya bola tha main? When it collides, it doesn't change its direction. Is it right down? Collision doesn't change the direction. Okay. So this expression we have got is wrong. Because these are not just assumptions, they are stupid assumptions. Okay, so actual value should be less than this or more than this? Collision, more collision should happen or less collision will happen? More collision will happen, right? So experimentally it was found out that n is equal to 1 divided by root 2 times n pi d square. This is the correct expression. You just plot a graph, you get it empirically. Write it down. Okay, let's do one numerical before this chapter is over. You need to find out mean free path. Find out mean free path for water molecule in water vapor at 373 Kelvin. Okay, for a water molecule in a water vapor, what is the mean free path at 373 Kelvin? Okay, first you tell me what is the value of small n. Density is given to you. Density is 0.6 kg per meter cube. Tell me what is the value of small n. I'll tell you the diameter of the water molecule. Anyone got small n? How much it is? The value of number of molecules per unit volume. 30? It should be a big number or a small number? Should be very big. Small water molecules are spread across a per meter cube. 1 meter cube is a big volume. It should be millions. How much? 33. Only 33 water molecules are there in 1 meter cube. It's almost like you. Huh? Bore, let it go. Are you bore? Yeah, no. You said something, some value said. Should I do it? It's easy. That's the thing. Density is given from density, you can directly find small n. Another thing. See, you guys are not using common sense. You are just looking, oh, which formula to apply? Where is the formula? Where is the formula? Formula in here. Use common sense, you get the value of small n. No one?
No one.
What? 33 into 6 into? Kya bol raha hai?
1.98 into 10 to the power 24.
No.
Haan. Sir, that's 25.
24 you said. 25 you said. Okay. How to find that density is? Listen here. 0.6 kg per meter cube. All I have to do is to find out how many water molecules are there in 0.6 kg. Because 0.6 kg will have 1 meter cube volume. Isn't it? Okay. So 0.6 kg has number of molecules equal to 600 grams divided by 18 into Avogadro number. These many molecules per meter cube. That's it. This is the answer. This is equal to 2 into 10 to the power 25. Now find the mean free path. Don't make me do that as well. Diameter is 4 angstrom. You know Armstrong?
Yes, sir.
Neil Armstrong. I gave us two names. 1/√2, huh? 1/√2 wala formula you have to use. You have to use this formula, 1/√2 times pi d square into n.
It can't be, it could be very small.
Don't tell me 2 kilometers.
No, no, it's very small. Minus 6.
How much?
The weight.
Huh? 0.028.
No.
1 divided by 16 into 10 is power minus 20. क्या 4 square 16 नहीं किया तुम लोगों ने?
मैं देख सकता
हूँ. 4 square को 4 ले लिया. ओह. That only I told you. That was